devastated Capitol lawn. A lone horseman with sword drawn. And there is a story. But like all of history, the timeline is not a flat line. Over 150 years later, that story is still alive. Hey, Paddy dear, now did you hear the news that's going round? The shamrock is forbid by law to grow on Irish ground. No more St. Patrick's Day would keep his colour, can't be seen. They're hanging men and women for the wearing of the green. Thomas Francis Meagher, not Meagher, was born into this background to a Catholic family August 23rd, 1823, in Waterford, Ireland, under British rule for 700 years, give or take a month or two. Meagher's father, also a Thomas, was a well-to-do businessman, the first Catholic mayor of Waterford in over 200 years, and a member of Parliament. A young Thomas was sent to Jesuit primary school in England, where the headmaster was determined to cure him of his horrid Irish brogue. This, of course, set him up for all sorts of pranks played on against his British masters. It also set him on the path to become one of the nation's most beloved orators and speakers and writers. He played clarinet in the school band and was severely reprimanded for refusing to play a song to honor the British. He won awards for writing and debating and graduated with honors. Thomas's early acquaintances included Percy Shelley, whose wife Mary wrote Frankenstein, and he may have romanced one Lady Jane L.G., who wrote poetry under the name Speranza. She became Lady Jane Wilde, Oscar Wilde's famous mother. But when Thomas first met her, she was already entrenched in the radical Young Ireland movement, which Thomas joined enthusiastically in 1847. For 2 years, he spoke and wrote fiercely for Irish independence. Come all ye young rebels, and list while I sing, for the love of one's country is a terrible thing. It banishes fear with the speed of the flame, and makes us all part of the patriot game. Now, some regard Meagher with admiration, others with disdain. You know, such individuals, past or present, never avoid controversy. And so our story begins. Thomas Francis Meagher, 5'9" tall, brown hair, blue eyes, not the other way around, medium build, yet larger than life. And now as I lie here, reviewing my role, I think of those traitors who bargained in souls, and I wish that my rifle had given the same to those who had played out the patriot game. And I played in my part in the patriot game. Movement preached insurrection against Britain, and Meagher became its most vocal spokesman. 1847, however, was unsettled. Famine had sent millions of Irish to America or to the grave. Incensed over England's landlord's treatment of Irish tenants, Thomas became inflamed when he learned that food supplies, which were plentiful in Ireland, were being shipped overseas by the British, leaving the Irish people to starve. He went to France and returned with a newly designed Irish flag. Yes, it was inspired by the French Revolution's red, white, and blue. Meagher's new flag represented green for the Catholics, orange for Protestants, and the white in between signified the hoped-for peace between the two. as he said, "I hope one day to see this flag waving as our national banner. We must now take up the banner with saber, pike, and gun. We must brave the darkest hour, for our battle has just begun. We must fight and take no prisoners in this revolution, as we fight to keep our nation proud and free." Young Ireland wanted a British Parliament to stay where they were and divide it into a separate Irish Parliament. Meagher organized hurling clubs to train and recruit young members. But it was a bad time for revolution. Famine took precedence. "The sword of famine," he said, "is less sparing than the bayonet of the soldier." Tired of debate, with venom and fury, he delivered the speech of his lifetime. His accent had settled somewhere between classical English, thank you, Jesuits, and traditional Irish, where it remained for the remainder of his life. The tense Dublin crowd quieted to the eloquent spell of a born orator. "A strong people alone can build a great nation. To be strong, a people must be self-reliant, self-ruled, self-sustained. Voters' certificates, books and pamphlets, newspapers are the only weapons that we employ. Abhor the sword? Stigmatize the sword? No, for it is the right of a nation to govern herself. Not in this hall, but upon the ramparts, purchased by the effusion of generous blood. Abhor the sword? No. In defense or in the assertion of a liberty, I hail the sword as a sacred weapon." Ever after, Thomas Francis, just 23 years old, would be known as Meagher of the Sword. The new rebellion was fixed for June 1848. The Irish tricolor flew proudly over their meetings, illegally. "There is green in the flag to honor Ireland's verdant fields, and the white is like the color of our fathers' high ideals, and the orange is like the color of the brave young blood that spilled in our fight to make this nation unite every nation, in our fight to keep this nation proud and free, proud and free." Was doomed by bad planning and fate. Two factors that would haunt Meagher for the rest of his life. He was impetuous and passionate, a dangerous combination. After several miscues, the rebels were arrested and tried for treason against the crown. And when the judge asked, "So, Mr. Meagher, what have you to say in your defense?" His reply was eloquent, yet most people only remember the last. "My lord, this is not our first offense, nor will it be our last. If spared, sure we'll not be so foolish as to be caught again." The judges were not amused. Meagher and the others were sentenced to death by hanging, drawing, and quartering. Apparently the British took no chances. Another of his most famous speeches, called "From the Dock," followed. "I know this crime entails the penalty of death, but the history of Ireland explains that crime and justifies it. Judged by that history, the treason of which I stand convicted loses all guilt, sanctified as a duty, ennobled as a sacrifice." Well, Queen Victoria could not argue with that last point. And maybe the judges were moved. Maybe they just didn't want another martyr to rally others to the cause. More likely, his important father pulled some strings. Regardless of the reason, the sentence was commuted to life transportation in Van Diemen's Land, Tasmania. He boarded the Swift and set sail. Swift. It took 3.5 months to get there. he would never see Ireland again. And as we wallop around Cape Horn, heave away, haul away, you wish to catch, you'd never been born, we're bound for South Australia. Haul away, rolling king, heave away, haul away, haul away, oh hear me sing, we're bound for South Australia. Haul away, oh hear me sing, we're bound for South Australia. Now Van Diemen's population at that time was about 65,000, over half of those were prisoners. Because Meagher and the others were political crimes, they weren't treated as common criminals, but as ticket of leave prisoners. That means that they could move around pretty freely if they just reported into the magistrate twice a year. But as political prisoners, they were subject to other criteria. Number one, they had to give their word of honor that they would not try to escape. Number two, they could not leave the district allotted to them, nor leave their house after 10 p.m. at night. Number three, they had to appear once a month before the magistrate. And number four, they could not live within 30 miles of or communicate with fellow prisoners. Well, Meagher settled in Hobart on Lake Sorel, and he built a little boat, and he called it Speranza. Remember her? Now, it's not known for sure, but she may have been the same girl who sent all of his letters back that Christmas, asking him to either return hers or destroy them. Heartsick, the news rekindled thoughts of rebellion in Meagher. From the mast of his little boat, proudly waved the Irish tricolor. And then one day he stopped to help a broken-down carriage on the road, and in it was one Catherine Bennett, the governess to an important doctor's children, and they started seeing one another. And they were married in 1851. They were an unlikely couple, according to many, from totally different social backgrounds. Even with his new life, Meagher was becoming more and more restless. And it's home, boys, home. Home I'd like to be, home for a while in the old country, where the oak and the ash and the bonny rowan tree are all growing greener in the old country, where the oak and the ash and the bonny rowan tree are all growing greener in the old country. In 1852, he made arrangements to escape. And you could do it in those days if you just wrote a letter to the authorities telling them that that's what you planned to do. So that's what he did, you see? It was all about honor in those days. Well, the next day, around twilight, the police arrived at his home to arrest him. And with his horse tied just inside the timberline, Meagher showed himself briefly enough, then leaped aboard the horse and rode like the wind just as the police opened fire, narrowly missing him. He rode to a prearranged spot where he was met by some fishermen who rowed him out into the ocean to a little island to wait for a passing ship. But the ship was late because the weather was bad. And after 10 desperate, cold, wet, hungry days, the ship finally came and Meagher was whisked aboard by a captain who was sympathetic to his cause. Now, Thomas Francis Meagher was one of the few men ever to escape Van Diemen's Land. His wife, Catherine, stayed with her parents, and shortly after he'd escaped, she gave birth to a baby boy who soon died. By the time he got to New York by way of South America, the other conspirators, oddly enough, had been pardoned. And many of them, strangely, went on to attain high government positions with the governments of Canada, Australia, and Ireland. Now, two others even became generals in the American Civil War. Had Meagher not escaped, he may have been granted the same, and yet it's unlikely that he would have accepted. He was so much against accepting anything from the British Crown, including a reduced sentence. Such is the code of honor. Oh, as a side note, the penal colony called Van Diemen's Land, which was begun in 1812, was abandoned in May 1853, 10 months after his escape, and it was renamed Tasmania. With a good case of pistols all in his right hand, like Hector so bold, young Meagher did stand. Is it me that you want? Young Meagher did cry. Now go try your best, for your skill I defy. Young Meagher that moment he bid them goodbye. To his horse he gave spurs and he opened their eyes. From Van Diemen's Land then he gave them leg bail, and he sailed to New York on the back of a whale. That's the first of many songs about Thomas Meagher's life and accomplishments. The good case of pistols, of course, is a gross exaggeration on the part of the anonymous poet. And we're still checking into the back of the whale theory. It was probably a boat. Well, New York was about 20% Irish in those days, and they greeted Meagher with a hero's welcome, which he declined humbly in deference to his fellow conspirators back in Van Diemen's Land, whom he did not know at that point had been pardoned. So the New York Fall Lecture Circuit included Thomas Francis Meagher. Now, Meagher's wife, Catherine, joined him shortly thereafter the next year. But any happiness that the couple may have experienced in Lake Sorel was not rekindled in New York. She was socially out of place, and Meagher, to his discredit, did not include her in many of his affairs. And after four tense, quarrelsome months, she returned to Ireland with child again. After giving birth to another son, Thomas Bennett, Catherine died. Thomas thought it best for the child to remain in Ireland with his father until he could return to take care of him, but that never happened. In the 18 months after Catherine's death, Thomas Meagher met Elizabeth Townsend. Now, her father had forged a chain and stretched it across the harbor on the Hudson River to keep the British from coming up the river during the Revolutionary War. And this may have resonated with Meagher initially, anything to thwart the British, you know. Now, they were married in November 1855 against the wishes of her father, but he soon softened when he realized that Thomas was actually going to make a good living as a lawyer, a writer, and a lecturer, and a newspaper man. Now, he and Elizabeth spent over a year in Panama trying to create a railroad across the isthmus, but that deal fell through. And he saw the Indians in South America in the same light as repressed Irish peasants back home, and this view would return to inspire him a few years later. So in early 1861, Meagher's legal reputation peaked in the celebrity trial of the day. Philip Key was the U.S. Attorney General that time, and the grandson of Francis Scott Key, the author of The Star-Spangled Banner. Well, Key had had an illicit affair with a congressman's wife that ended in a crime of passion. But Meagher got him off. The first defense in legal history that used temporary insanity as a plea. He seemed destined for greatness, but for the fact of a noted fondness for alcohol. And if I get drunk, well, the money's me own, and if them don't like me, can leave me alone. I'll tune me fiddle and I'll rosin me bow, and I'll be welcome wherever I go. On the eve of the American Civil War, Meagher likened the Irish immigrants to the slaves. In fact, Meagher was so empathetic to the black man's cause, he was originally a Southern sympathizer. He saw the coming conflict as an opportunity to train Irish troops under fire and return to Ireland with a battle-hardened militia to eject the British. And most of the Irish at that time thought, ah, sure, why not? So finally he decided that fighting for the Union side would increase his chances of victory. You see, back in those days, most people thought that what later became known as the Civil War was just a minor police action that would be over in a couple of weeks. He joined the 69th New York Militia shortly after the firing on Fort Sumter. And his command of the British, of the Irish Brigade, would be the stuff of legend. Now, Meagher praised his newly formed brigade of rough Irish volunteers. If only 1 in 10 comes back after this conflict is over, the military experience will be of more service than with the entire 10 as they are now. He modeled his troops after Algerian zouaves with their flashy red shirts, the firemen of the Irish Brigade. In the hottest of the fire, there rode along the line a captain of the Zouave band, crying, "Now, boys, is your time. Oh, who so boldly rides with the bold and dauntless men? 'Tis Thomas Francis Meagher of old Erin's Isle of Green." At First Bull Run, Thomas was said to have courage and coolness under fire, enduring his men to him with the call, "Now is your time, boys. Raise the colors and follow me." But Bull Run was a disaster. Many of the Irish were killed. They accused Sherman of bias for refusing to send enough supplies, feeling that the Irish were used merely as expendable cannon fodder. Being overpowered by numbers, our troops were forced to flee. The Southern Black Horse Cavalry on them charged furiously. But in the hour of peril, the flying master screamed, stood the gallant New York firemen and the boys that wore the green. General Meagher petitioned President Lincoln to let him return to New York and recruit more Irish troops. Lincoln was so impressed that the two of them became friends. Meagher's appointment then as Brigadier General put him in the company of elite Irish generals in the Union Army. Corcoran, Nugent, Farnham, McClellan. But the Irish were decimated. The 1 in 10 he had mentioned earlier was coming horribly true. As one reporter wrote, "When anything absurd or desperate is attempted, the Irish Brigade is called upon." The original 3,000 members of the Irish Brigade, less than 300 remained. Farewell, my gallant countrymen, who fell that fatal day. Farewell, ye noble firemen, now mouldering in the clay. Yet blooms the leafy shamrock, yet runs the old machine. Your deeds will live, bold red shirts and the boys that wore the green. Army Chaplain Father Corby admired Meagher for his dedication to his men and to his Catholic faith. While the general did drink too much on occasion, Father Corby defended him. After the general's horse was shot out from under him and he landed on his head, he was accused of drunkenness, but no one ever actually reported seeing him drink. He likely had a concussion, which exhibits many of the same symptoms. Father Corby said, "By no means is he a drunkard," and passed it off with the pet name for whiskey of the day, "O.B. Joyful," or "Who Hit John." Corby became the first president of Notre Dame. Your deeds will live, bold red shirts and the boys that wore the green. Maria Daly, no relation to Marcus, was one of Meagher's adamant champions in those days. But she suddenly became one of his most venomous detractors overnight, aided by newspaper man Thomas Dimmesdale, a Southern supporter. Dimmesdale was more than happy to run down Meagher on any occasion. It was later discovered that Mrs. Daly's husband had aspirations to run for Congress, and he felt that Meagher's popularity might diminish his chances in the race. Can you imagine political underhandedness in those days? Dimmesdale, however, would continue his anti-Meagher campaign, as he said, for the rest of his life, even including Elizabeth Meagher in his personal attacks. Lincoln may have liked Meagher. Sherman thought he was an embarrassment, but the Irish troops loved him, and they especially loved Libby Meagher, who often joined her husband on the battlefield to minister to the sick and wounded of the Irish Brigade, now known as Mrs. Meagher's Own. She kept in contact with many of her brigade boys for the rest of her life. The Irish Brigade, under its green banner with a gold harp, fought in all of the early major battles of the Civil War, each man wearing a little sprig of green in his cap to identify them. Robert E. Lee's own troops cheered and applauded the Irish Brigade, and it was Lee himself who christened them the Fighting 69th. Saddened by the killing and needing to recoup from several serious injuries received on the battlefield, Thomas complained, "Irish-born citizens are fiercely indignant at their treatment by the Senate." He resigned in frustration and anger, but he was reinstated a year later. When Johnny comes marching home again, hurrah, hurrah, we'll give him a hearty welcome then, hurrah, hurrah. The men will cheer and the boys will shout, the ladies, they will all turn out and we'll all feel gay when Johnny comes marching home. Our Civil War ended April 9th, 1865, with Lee's surrender to Grant. 5 days later, President Lincoln was assassinated. Among the pallbearers at his funeral were Thomas Francis Meagher. And we'd all feel gay when... Lincoln may have liked Meagher. Grant was indifferent. Sherman wanted him out of Washington after the war, far out. So Sherman petitioned President Johnson to appoint Meagher as secretary of the newly formed Montana Territory. And as we all know, there's no place farther from civilization than Montana. Well, he joined a Minnesota wagon train westbound from Red River Valley country, going overland and then by river, and finally stagecoach to the capital at Bannock. From this valley, they say you are going. I will miss your bright eyes and sweet smile, but remember the Red River Valley that brightens our pathway a while. His beloved wife, Elizabeth, would join him a little later. Come and sit by my side if you love me. Do not hasten to bid me adieu, but remember the Red River Valley and the one who has loved you so true. Now we all know that the first governor of Montana was Sidney Edgerton. But when Thomas arrived in September of 1865, Edgerton promptly gathered all of his cabinet together and took them back east. It gets cold in Montana. So for all practical purposes, acting Governor Meagher was the governor of Montana Territory. The capital was moved to Virginia City, and the governor's mansion was was a one-room log cabin. There's a replica of it still on the same spot today. It was going to be a tough go, but Meagher was no quitter. President Johnson asked him to bring Montana to statehood, and that's exactly what he intended to do. He told a welcoming party he could not be yoked, coaxed, or broken, or tamed to any party. My party is the people of the United States. That's pretty good, huh? Of course, he was immediately opposed by the rich and powerful. You see, Montana was heavily populated by Southern supporters, and Meagher, a Union hero, was not liked from the onset by disenfranchised Confederates. Meagher of the Sword was suddenly being referred to derisively as the acting one. Still, the common people liked him, especially the thousands of Irish who were starting to immigrate to Montana to work the mines. You brave Irish heroes, wherever you may be, pray stand for a moment and listen to me. Your sons and fair daughters are going away, and thousands are sailing to America. The Montana Territory at this time boasted a non-Indian population of 30,000. Yeah, it was starting to get crowded. Meagher saw Montana as a place for Irish immigrants to build a strong colony and propel himself to a possible U.S. Senate seat. It is my heart's desire to be champion of the Irish race in these great wild mountains. So good luck to those people, and safe may they land. They're leaving their country for a far distant strand. They're leaving old Ireland no longer to stay, and thousands are sailing to America, and thousands are sailing to America. Now, as acting governor, Meagher was also, by default, superintendent of Indian affairs. He felt that the Indians were not represented fairly, and he criticized the government's treaty policies openly. And this didn't make him any points either. Repression, imposed religion, starvation, he saw the Indians in the same light as Irish peasants 20 years earlier in his homeland. The same light as he saw the South American Indians on his way from escaping Diemen's land. And of course, revolt against oppression may have also resonated quite strongly with him. So he went to Browning that winter to sign a treaty with the Blackfeet. Bad weather followed. You know, it's 165 miles one way from Virginia City to Browning. It's about 2.5 hours today. I can make it in 2. Imagine going by horseback in the wintertime. As he wrote in his journals, the snow, in a way, had it all its own way. The treaty then went overland to San Francisco to go by ship down to Panama, over the isthmus by railroad, to get another ship in the Atlantic, up the coast, and finally to be delivered by coach to Congress. But the original courier died in California, and the treaty never made it. Thomas appointed Peter Ronan as superintendent of public affairs, public instruction. He vetoed a public compensation proposal because he felt the superintendent's salary was too low, saying education is one of the most important duties that we can be called on to perform. That's pretty good too, huh? Now, at that time, he also lobbied the archdiocese of the Catholic religion to appoint a bishop to Montana. And the Indians asked for Father De Smet. And when Elizabeth came up the river in 1806, they rode the same riverboat together. The Meaghers then visited Father Ravalli in Stevensville and the mission in St. Ignatius, where he named the two highest peaks the Twin Sisters and christened a 4,000-foot waterfall Elizabeth, claiming to be the first white man to ever see it. That's my backyard. However, it's also a fact that his drinking was becoming a burden. Hello, fairly well. Hem tilly a doodle and a da, me tilly a doodle and a da. Parents for total laddie, oh, there's whiskey in the jar. Hey, whiskey, you're the devil, you're leading me astray. Over hills and mountains into a merry game. You're sweeter, stronger, dacenter, you're spunkier than Tay. Oh, whiskey, you're me darling, drunker sober. Oh, whiskey, you're me darling, drunker sober. You seem to like the drinking song. By early 1867, Meagher was beginning to receive death threats from the vigilantes. His rudimentary legislature angered the profiteers out to make a buck on the frontier of Montana. Rumors flew in the state's most powerful newspapers run by his venomous detractors. And to complicate things, vigilante justice was being turned against the Indians. In fact, they manufactured an Indian scare in the Gallatin Valley to convince General Sherman to send firearms. Later investigation discovered that there never were any settlers killed in the Gallatin Valley at that time, except for one, John Bozeman himself. And those who knew him thought that he had provoked the fight. And many thought that it was only a matter of time. So Sherman, determined to end the Indian wars at all costs and as quickly as possible, agreed to send 2,500 rifles up the river to the port at Fort Benton, and he commissioned Thomas Meagher to receive the shipment. It was his last official duty. On the 60-mile trip from Fort Shaw to Fort Benton in the summer's heat, Meagher and his entire party were dehydrated and ill with summer sickness. That's diarrhea. Now, we're all from Montana, right? We know summer's heat. We know horseback. We know summer sickness. Can you imagine 60 miles? With illness and threats on his life, his friends asked him to stay aboard a riverboat that night. And all through the evening, he asked, "Why did the vigilantes want me dead? I tried to be fair to all." And that night, July 1st, 1867, Thomas Francis Meagher disappeared. Rumors flew that he was drunk, and fell overboard, and was drowned in the Missouri, high and swift with runoff. But those who knew him denied that. No one came forth to say otherwise, but he was reported to be a strong swimmer. Elizabeth rushed to Fort Benton from Helena. She searched the riverbanks for 2 months, but his body was never found. He was 7 weeks short of his 44th birthday. We shall meet, but we shall miss him. There will be one vacant chair. We shall linger to caress him while we breathe our evening prayer. When a year ago we gathered, joy was in his mild blue eye. But a golden cord is severed, and our hopes in ruins lie. circumstances surrounding Meagher's death have been conflicting ever since. Remember, there was no CNN, no Fox News, mercifully, no mass media of any kind. We shall meet, but we shall miss him. There will be one vacant chair. We shall linger to caress him while we breathe our evening prayer. While we breathe our evening prayer. Now what we do know is that he was sick and he was broke. He'd been threatened and he was despondent. He had been relieved of his governor's duties. His replacement was already on the way upriver. He was asked to stay aboard the riverboat Thompson by the pilot, Johnny Duran, who had ferried the boat that brought his wife up earlier. His clothes were discovered in his room, but he and his nightshirt were gone. There was neither blood nor signs of a struggle. And no fewer than 9 theories exist about his disappearance. He was sick, disoriented. The railing outside his cabin was broken. He tripped on a coil of rope and fell overboard and drowned. He was shot by hostile Indians. Unlikely. The Indians liked him. There was a woman involved. There's always a woman involved. And he leaped overboard, swam across shore, and joined her, and they skipped to Canada. Now, really, wouldn't there be a better way, an easier way to do that? He was killed by the Klan over his support of northern policies. He was killed by disgruntled Indian agents. You know, he'd caught several of them stealing supplies that were meant for the Indians. Now, one fella said later that he was there that night and knew that Meagher was despondent and had no prospects and was broke and owed everyone and saw him jump. And again, those who knew him stoutly disavowed that theory. There was never an official government inquiry into the disappearance of a high-ranking government official, suggesting possibly a government cover-up, if you can imagine. Another theory states that he was killed by British agents, still mad about his escape from Van Diemen's Land. We'll return to this in just a few minutes here. Now, one fellow even confessed on his deathbed that the vigilantes had paid him, one source says $4,000, one says $8,000, to shoot Meagher and throw his body overboard. But when the fellow got better, he recanted his story. A miner who was working a claim downriver of Fort Benton at that time said, "I am positive that the vigilantes had Meagher killed. He was not drowned by accident, and everyone living in the territory at that time knew it." Complicating everything, most of the reports of his disappearance were written by his bitter enemy, Wilbur Fisk Sanders, who was a shady character in his own right. In fact, it was well known that Sanders had already written a letter ordering a quietus against the man, which effectively said, "Meagher has lived long enough. He just disappeared." Or did he? In 1899, a prospector working a claim 6 miles downriver of Fort Benton found a desiccated body on the shore, dressed in the remains of a nightshirt, 5'9" tall, with a hole in the forehead right between the eyes. This is what gave rise to the British agent theory, because that was the customary execution method of British agents at the time. Well, he sold the body to Arthur Miles, who dressed it in a U.S. Army uniform and showed it for 2 bits of pop, claiming it was General Thomas Francis Meagher. Really, 32 years later. Miles said he intended to send the corpse to the Smithsonian, Institute has no such record of receiving it. Miles died in 1933, and no such cargo was among his possessions. I'm bidding you a long farewell, my errand bright and true. I'll not forget you, darling, in the world I'm going to. They say there's bread and work for all, and the sun shines always there. But I can't forget old Ireland, were it 50 times as fair. Immigrants continued to flock to Montana as Meagher had hoped, mostly to work the Butte mines. The 1900 census claimed over 8,000 Irish in Butte, a quarter of the population, the highest concentration of Irish in any American town at that time. 21% of the U.S. cavalry was Irish, and over 100 killed with Custer at the Bighorn claimed Irish ancestry. And we know our first capital was Bannock, later moved to Virginia City, where some wanted it kept. With statehood in 1889, it moved again. And the newspapers said, the Irish want the capital in Anaconda, but real Americans prefer Helena. I live for freedom in Ireland, and America brave and true. So hang my harp on the willow tree, as I bid my last adieu. To honor him, Meagher County was named in November 1867 with White Sulphur Springs as the county seat. And soon after, the first Montana chapter of the Ancient Order of Hibernians, a philanthropic Catholic men's organization, was organized in Montana. The AOH set up a new company to sell subscriptions, raising private funds for a statue of Meagher standing proudly on the Montana State Capitol lawn since 1905. The company's president was another notable Montana Irishman, Marcus Daly. Now, Daly spent millions on the campaign to have the capital stay in Anaconda, ultimately losing to his bitter rival, William Clark, who supported Helena. Clark also spent millions and a few dollars more. And of course, if you can imagine, the vote was not without controversy. Daly's statue then, with its backside facing the building, was Daly's raised middle finger to Clark's new capital. Elizabeth Meagher, who had moved back to New York after her husband's death, was 70 years old and in poor health, and she did not attend. She often said, I light a candle tonight and talk to Thomas. She died the following year, in July of 1906. They had no children. Fort Elizabeth Meagher, just outside of Bozeman, was established in May of 1867 and decommissioned in August of 1867. Not sure the reasoning of that. President Kennedy honored him and the Irish Brigade in a much publicized visit to Ireland in 1963, where he presented to Parliament a flag that the Irish Brigade had carried during the Civil War. A statue of him was erected in Waterford, Ireland, just around the corner from his birthplace, in 2004. There's also a small statue of him outside the Nine Fine Irishmen pub in Las Vegas. How's that for a tribute? I also heard that there's a bust of Meagher inside that pub with a big screen TV in front of it. I'm going down there next weekend, and I'm going to find out if that's true, and we'll have something to say about that, won't we? Ultimately, his legacy should stress courage, statesmanship, dedication to Irish freedom and American justice, not accidental death, nor struggles with alcohol. So hang my harp on the willow tree as I bid my last adieu. As a final historical note, Meagher's only child, and that by his first wife, Catherine, was raised in Ireland. And while Thomas Bennett Meagher tried to follow in his famous father's footsteps, his military bent was not inherited. He did enroll in West Point, but he flunked out. Twice. And his life was marked by various business adventures, some successful, some not. And one such took him to the Philippines, where he died at the age of 56, around 1909. His children had children, and many Meagher descendants still survive today. Now, Thomas Meagher's birthplace still stands in Waterford, Ireland. It's now the Granville Hotel. And the Irish group I sing with, the Montana Shamrockers, went to Ireland in 2014 to meet with Anne Cusack, the unofficial Secretary of State of Montana. We took her a Montana state flag, which had flown above the statue of Meagher, accompanied by an official proclamation signed to that effect by the governor. And she still flies the Montana flag every day over the Granville Hotel. We're going back next year to take her another one. And here we are, ready to perform in the Thomas Meagher room of the Granville Hotel. In June of 2009, the Thomas Francis Meagher chapter of the AOH dedicated a bust to their namesake at Fort Benton, a black granite base, 6'7" tall, that's this tall right here, that's me, supports an heroic bronze bust on the Missouri riverbank, where it's thought that he disappeared. We were asked to write some songs commemorating the occasion. We were proud to include them on one of our albums. As a matter of fact, there are some albums over here that you might want to look at. Some of our Irish albums and some of mine, some with some of the songs from this program are on those albums. Be glad to visit with you after that, the show tonight. And the Meagher story continued from that moment on to resonate with us. Our research is fascinating, ongoing, and rewarding. Sing of Corcoran and Nugent, McClellan and Farnham, but there's few sons of Erin remembered by far. Like the bravest young kinsmen, the best of them bar none, Montana's first statesman, Montana's great star. Whether murder most foul or strange miscalculation cut short his potential at age 44. Sing praise to the gallant Irish battalion and their handsome young leader, proud Tom Francis Meagher. Thanks to everyone who made tonight possible. Thanks, of course, to the Montana Historical Society for bringing me in here to do the show for you tonight. Thanks to Kirby and all the staff here. Of course, I'm going to forget everybody's names, but thanks for your help today, setting up and everything. And I don't think this is the first time that a lot of you have been in this building. Please don't make it your last. Exhibits are changing all the time as we find out more and more about Montana history. And thank you for letting me share this fascinating, colorful story. I'd love to visit with you after the show here. Answer any questions if I can. Remember, we're not out to take sides about Thomas Meagher. We're only reporting the facts as we know them today. We may learn new things tomorrow. As he said himself, when men speak much and often, they cannot sometimes help but speak wrong. So now you know the story behind the statue on the Capitol lawn. Thomas Francis Meagher, patriot, freedom fighter with unwavering convictions for better or worse, a proud Irishman, Montana's own Meagher of the sword. Sing praise to the gallant Irish battalion. proud town, Francis Meagher.
Thank you very much.